Hello, I'm David Shukman, and delighted to be your host for this special engineering review of what can only be described as a tumultuous year. We're still in the grip of the COVID-19 pandemic, and fresh from COP26, that climate mega summit that's just taken place in Glasgow. So a huge year on many, many counts. And so we're going to be asking some top engineers for their highs and lows of the past 12 months. For me, without doubt, the biggest story of the year has been climate. And in fact, for many years, I've had a witness view of, a first-hand view of many of the great changes affecting the planet, from rising temperatures, melting of the polar ice caps, the effect on sea levels, the impact on communities on coasts around the world, and so much else beside. The fact is that we are now living on a planet that's 1 degree hotter than in pre-industrial times, and there are consequences. We've seen the terrible extremes of heat and fire in Greece and Canada, terrible deadly floods in Germany and in New York, and of course the UK is not immune to any of this. More extremes, new records being set, and the appalling story of people without power for best part of a fortnight after a storm the other day. So great deal to talk about on tonight's discussion. But there is good news. I'm an optimist. When humans have their backs against the wall, they can be very ingenious. And I'm delighted to say that the humans who are the exemplars of that are, of course, engineers. So our focus this evening very much is on the engineering perspective of the great events of the last 12 months or so. What we can do about carbon emissions, about COVID, and about the post-pandemic recovery. This event is supported by BP. It set out its own aims to be a net zero company by 2050 or sooner, and to help the world get to net zero. And we're going to be taking your questions. I know many of you are poised to submit questions already. To do that, please use the Slido link that's pinned at the top of the YouTube chat feature, and you can submit questions at any point during this evening's discussion, and we'll try to get through as many as we can of them for our panel. Let me introduce that panel. Star-studded, terrific to see you all here. George Imafidon, Chief Executive of Motivez, works with Sir Lewis Hamilton on the X44 Extreme E racing team, bringing electric racing to some of the most remote corners of the planet. Cathy Davis, joining us down the line, who's head of strategy and sustainability and many other things as well at BAE Systems, where she's overseeing the company's goal of achieving net zero greenhouse gas emissions across its operations by 2030, a pretty ambitious target there. Dr. Shaun Fitzgerald, director of the Centre for Climate Repair at the University of Cambridge, also an expert on ventilation. Shaun and I managed to get ventilation on the 6 o'clock news in the context of COVID-19. We'll be talking more about that. Dr. Hayatun Silem, next to me here, chief executive of both the Royal Academy of Engineering and of the Queen Elizabeth Prize for Engineering. And she co-chaired the Hamilton Commission with the famous racing driver, looking at how to get more young black people into that sport. Welcome to all of you. Great to have you all here, and Cathy there on a giant TV, I should say. Welcome to you all. I'm going to ask each of you just to give us, in 2 minutes, what for you was the big story from an engineer's perspective of 2021, and what the big challenge is for next year. George, I'm looking at you. Do you want to kick off?
Sure, David.
The floor is yours.
So I think similar to your opening point around the climate, I think the biggest challenge that we've seen in 2021, or kind of the biggest story, has been around EVs and electrification from my perspective. So we have climate change as being the biggest challenge. I think that's the next space race, if I'm being honest. And from that perspective, there's been a lot of different alternative technologies being developed, and some of that is kind of, you know, electric vehicles. And with that, you've seen a transition with many different sources, but oil has been much more expensive. I think around 30p or so more, you know, compared to last year. So as a result of that, you've had people considering these electric vehicles, and not just due to climate change and, you know, wanting to make a difference, but behavioral kind of changes as a result of prices as well. And people, even a cab driver that I spoke to was mentioning the prices are going up. He's having to essentially go into central London and pay more. So he's considering to, you know, a transition. So I think that's probably been the biggest one. And I've experienced it. We've helped to work on that technology as well, which has been amazing. So I think that's probably been the biggest story, just the fact that petrol prices and everything are increasing, and EVs are, you know, here and now, and it's not just a fad. And we've seen in the news, for example, the government, for new homes that are being built, should have electric, you know, charges and so forth. So this is becoming a thing in terms of the infrastructure from an engineering perspective to actually implement this, you know, new source.
What for you is the big challenge, the big engineering challenge for next year, just briefly?
I would say, kind of expanding on that, it's probably still going to be climate change.
Okay.
So the biggest story has been around EVs and electrification, but I say climate change will still be the biggest thing. That's why we've got the goals for 2030, 2050, you have to build momentum. So I think that would, again, be the biggest story.
Okay, I think we're going to hear more about this, aren't we? Yeah. Cathy, give us your big story of the past year and the big challenge of next year.
So I'm going to agree with you both that it's COP26 and that sustainable future. I think for me, it's the change in people and their acceptance of what needs to happen that's really important. It's been a really big turning point this year. That might be because of COP26, it could be because of all the media interventions that we've had explaining what's going on, but it's probably down to the fact that actually we're all experiencing that change in climate now. And actually it's something that we talk about at the dinner table rather than leave to the scientists, which we've been doing for the last, you know, 30 years, isn't it? So that's the kind of the setting for next year. You know, the challenge for our industry is very similar to that for the commercial airlines and the big shipping companies. You know, if we want to fly long haul again, if we want to have all the commodities shipped to us in a sustainable way, we've got to solve the problem of fossil fuels. And that is, you know, electrification is great. You know, George has alluded to that. It's absolutely brilliant what's been achieved in that, but it doesn't fix all of those problems. So sustainable liquid fuels are the thing that I think we need to be working on. And that solution is, well, it's really complicated, isn't it, right? Because it needs kind of government policy, it needs economic levers, and quite a lot of R&D behind it to actually make sure that we can produce fuels that are both affordable and scalable. Yeah, so that's the big one.
Cathy, thank you. That is a big challenge. Okay, Shaun, your turn. Look back, look forward.
Well, so David, as you know, you and I have had some great times this year. And I wear two hats, so as director of the Centre for Climate Repair, and probably it's the climate that really clinches it. And there were two bits about the climate that really I really took to heart. So the first one we all know about, which was COP26 and the Glasgow and just raising the game. But I must say, David, it was a report that was issued a couple of months earlier in August by the IPCC that didn't get quite the airtime that I think it should have done. And there's one figure in there that really made it for me, which was one of the early ones, which is about the scenarios between now and 2100. And every one of those scenarios saw us sailing through 1.5 degrees centigrade. Now, admittedly, the most ambitious, aggressive emissions reduction scenario then saw us dipping back below 1.5 degrees C by 2100, but we went through it. And for me, this is actually what we need to shout from the rooftops and say, this is why engineers actually are needed, regardless of just how hard you go at emissions reduction. And we need to go as hard as we can. We need to do even more. And that's where engineering is going to really come to the fore, because just relying on nature to go and get us out of this mess That's not the answer. We need to work with nature, we need to support it, we need to amplify it, and then have engineering systems. So for me, that's the biggest one. And David, as you know, I am also absolutely delighted that we've got the message about getting fresh air into buildings as part of COVID. And for me, that's been very, very important about well-being, not just about the immediate health, but about the future of the health in our built environment. And going forwards, it is about the engineering, how we really go and tackle the climate, David. More on that later.
And I should say that there was a window that was open, but there were some very noisy builders outside. So we thought it was safer to have the window shut and hope that we're all going to be fine. We're nice and socially distanced, aren't we?
Well, but therein is a good example of where, in fact, you know, some engineering solutions to even a building that we're in today can actually make this building even better. It's good, and we need to make good even better.
Thank you. Hi, Artin. I know there's obviously a lot to discuss, a lot's been covered.
Absolutely. Well, let me offer my thoughts on this. So the story I'd like to pick out as being the biggest engineering story of the year from my perspective is the vaccine success story. And I want to claim a slice of this for engineering, because I think that, you know, we rightly celebrate these extraordinary scientists whose breakthroughs and incredible hard work, combined with this army of volunteers and our fantastic NHS, delivered all these incredible numbers of vaccines into our arms. But actually, engineers have also been crucial to enabling us to sit here double and triple vaxxed, hopefully. And I don't think that gets enough attention. So I'd like to give a shout out to those fantastic engineers who enabled us to scale up the manufacturing of these novel vaccines at an extraordinary pace and scale, who helped manage the logistics and supply chains. And I think that actually resonates with some of the other big engineering stories of the year around innovation, around supply chains, and around COVID. I think that as we look forward, I have to agree with my colleagues, the biggest challenge is to harness what we've proved to ourselves about what we can achieve when we're really ambitious, when we feel we've got no other choice, and bring that to bear on the climate challenge. But just to bring a little bit of variety into the conversation, I'm going to offer you a slightly alternative priority for the year ahead, which is to harness innovation and engineering industry to improve jobs and opportunity for people all around the UK. So this phrase, build back better, has become quite hackneyed, but it's actually what we need to do so that people can really experience the fruits of all of our strengths in research and engineering as improvements in their lives. So I think that's a big challenge and opportunity for the year
ahead. So those benefits are shared as widely as possible.
Absolutely, quite right.
Great. Well, look, we're going to hear more about all of these. And if you're just joining now, just to recap, we're talking about the engineering highlights of 2021 and looking forward. A lot about climate and COVID and jobs and skills across the country. So a great deal for us to discuss. Let's pick up on, I guess it is the big one for everybody, climate. I mean, at COP26, right at the end of it, I had news presenters asking me, did it work, did it fail, in a rather binary way. And I had to fall back on that rather hackneyed phrase about, is a glass half full or a glass half empty? Was 1.5 kept alive? One could argue that just about, but only if every promise offered on the table in Glasgow is actually kept. So it's all about, are pledges going to be honoured? Shaun, you were there, I think, for the second week. Obviously, you've analysed the outcome. There's a lot of spin around this, isn't there, about keeping 1.5 alive? I mean, did this thing go far enough?
There is a lot of spin, but what's important is to actually take the positives first, David. It really is. I mean, you're an optimist, I'm an optimist. We wouldn't be in this game if we're not. And the idea of looking what positives came out of COP. Look, 2015, there were various things set out in principle, but the rule book was not agreed. So there was some tidying up that was really, really important in order to build momentum and agreement between the nations. So there were some positive steps, and it's important that we acknowledge those and we work with the UN to say, look, this is the direction of travel. But in terms of answering the question of, is 1.5 still alive and did we go far enough? 1.5, as I mentioned the IPCC report depends on how you define 1.5. If you're going to define it by that end game of 2100, then perhaps, yes, it was just about kept alive. I've got grave concerns about the non-linearities in our climate system. And if we go through 1.5 degrees C, can I really believe the projections that are, for example, from 2070 to 2100, when you've already been through 1.5 degrees C, thinking about the impact of the Arctic, the release of methane, the release of carbon dioxide from those sorts of systems? And I think the accuracy of those models is going to be challenging. So to call it just about alive, you know, there were some lovely descriptions. So it's on the operating table. Yeah. You know, there were some fantastic descriptions by various people during the second week of the negotiations. So for me, it's going to be a difficult thing. The one thing that I think that was missing from COP26 that we're going to need to amplify a great more is that it isn't just about emissions reduction. Because emissions reduction, you know, is where we're basically turning the taps off. We're going to need to do a lot more than just emissions reduction to go and get the climate into a state that's going to be something that's going to be palatable. And we're going to need to get very serious with greenhouse gas removal and draining some of the greenhouse gases out of the atmosphere in order that we get to a 1.5 degrees C stable, if we think that is okay. And you very beautifully describe some of the rather severe weather events, even in this year. And that's not 1.5 degrees C, that's 1.2. Yeah. So 1.5 degrees C isn't looking very pretty either. So I think the engineering challenges that lie ahead are very much about taking the good out of COP26 and building on that and doing rather more.
And one of the big themes, George, was the growing prominence of young people in this debate inside the conference chamber and outside it. I'm thinking of Greta leading a huge march on the streets and so forth. As a representative of young people, what did you take out of that? Greta condemned the whole thing as a failure halfway through.
Yeah.
Because it wasn't going to achieve what the IPCC lays out. Mm. It was never going to achieve a 45% reduction in emissions by 2030. Or do you take some heart from some of what was agreed there?
I think similar to both of you, I'm an optimist. So I don't necessarily, you know, sit exactly where Greta sits, but I can empathize with her and kind of understand that, you know, just the feeling that this is politics and, you know, not much is really going to happen in this room because not much has happened, you know, in their belief before. So I'll start with the positives. And I think the positives were that young people were there. Young people were listening. Young people were using their voice. And I think that's the first thing, because the worst outcome is apathy, where people feel like they don't have a voice and they can't use it and nothing can happen. But I feel as though people felt as if when they shared their perspectives, Greta and others, that they were actually going to be heard in some way. And I think a lot of them were. Whether it leads to actions by governments and so forth is another story, and you can never be sure. But generally speaking, I think the first stage is mobilizing a group of people, mobilizing a group of young people and saying, you can actually solve these issues. And I think if they start on a local level, you know, for example, I grew up in Peckham. Peckham High Street is the 9th most polluted in kind of London, right? And, you know, Southwark is the 3rd in Southwark. So I can really use that and build a group of green leaders around to say, how do we reduce that? What can we put in the community?
And does that connect more than the big, more abstract idea?
That connects much more. So that's what I'm trying to do with my work, is really allow them to take them to Peckham High Street and then take them to Maidervale and say, you know, these are two different high streets. And as a result, why do you think this is the case? So you see that, you know, climate justice is racial justice is everything, right? So it's to let them understand the gravity of the situation and allow them to implement solutions locally, as opposed to just thinking about the global issue, which a lot of people feel disempowered. They don't necessarily feel that they can make a difference because the governments are there to do that. But on a local level, I feel if we can mobilize people, then we can see change.
Now, something that struck me during the course of COP26 was a lot of world leaders saying they understand why young people feel so frustrated. Now, you've rolled your eyes at that. Now, what's your reaction when you hear the Secretary General of the UN or former President Obama or others say, oh, yes, we understand the frustration of young people?
It's very difficult because if you understand, then you would expect a bit more action and, you know, a bit more agreement with the reports in terms of how are we going to meet these targets, these ambitious targets that we set out. And from industry and from a lot of the work that I've done so far, you see that there's not necessarily a plan there, just that a lot of people are experimenting different, you know, ways of achieving this from an engineering perspective, as we've heard before, in terms of sustainable fuels. I'm also looking into sustainable fuels because electrification is not enough. So there's a mix at the moment that people are exploring, but I think young people just want to see a lot more action. And that's why I'm encouraging them to start at a local level and then get some skin in the game from there, show what you've done and sell that to your local councillors and different people, and hopefully attract more funding opportunities and try and see if you can change things in a more
level. Such an interesting prescription that you've laid out there. Now, another one of the big changes with the whole COP process from my perspective, the first one I went to was COP 11 in 2005, can you believe? And I wasn't aware of a corporate presence at that event. Now, Cathy, over to you with this. I mean, clearly there was a much, much bigger sense of big corporations engaging with the climate topic. What for you came out of COP 26 that's useful to you for taking all this forward?
So that's really interesting. I mean, I can talk about the defence industry better than the broader industries, but there are certainly parallels between both streams. You know, and I think you're talking about what's the shift in behaviour sets for industry. And that's clearly driven, particularly in the UK, by the legislation. So the more kind of policy and pieces that are put into place, the more, you know, our stakeholders and our investors are thinking about this as well. And it becomes a problem that everybody is looking to solve rather than just one component of that group of stakeholders, okay? So I think that's really important. You know, our legislation is unique in the UK because we are the only people who've made that case. And, you know, every UK is reporting against that, every UK company rather is reporting against that, right? But what I would like to say is actually it's not just because of that people have been looking at this. So, you know, from our perspective, our company has been reporting our emissions for many, many years. And we've also been looking at reducing those emissions for many years, which may not be obvious, I guess, from outside of our industry. So, you know, I mean, I can give you some examples of that where we've repurposed a runway in Salisbury to put solar panels on there to actually kind of put in a number of the electricity generation that we need for the manufacturing components of the future Eurofighter Typhoons, the F-35 Lightnings, and the wings for the Hawk jet. Now, you kind of ask, well, have we done that for sustainability? Partly, but probably more because it's got an economic reason behind it. You know, let's be honest, there's a £300,000 saving in electricity for that, which is a great answer for our customers.
That's a key factor now. That's a key factor now in this equation.
I think both performance enhancements and cost reductions are really important trade-offs to consider in all of this. You know, sustainability is one angle, which, you know, we all see as really, really important. But actually, we've also got to make business cases as industry, and we've got to be able to show that these are valuable. So we've been able to do that with the Portsmouth Naval Base and help the Royal Navy reduce their carbon footprint by 60% over the last 15 years, which, you know, shows that we've been doing that for a long time. But again, it's about an economic impact for them to actually do that piece. So, you know, I think we have to remember how these things get enacted in industry, you know, and also the timeline it takes. So if we look at, for example, the Ministry of Defence, they're also changing. They've put a number of policies this year. So you may have seen climate change and sustainability strategies have been issued in March, and their plans to get to net zero by 2050. And all of this is really encouraging in terms of the epochs that they're going to go through to get to that point. Actually, behind the scenes, the engineers are doing a huge amount to help that get ready. So, you know, we've got a new mandate that we can put 50% synthetic fuels into all of the aircraft in the Royal Air Force. To do that, all of the equipment manufacturers have to work with RAF, the RAF, to actually certify those aircraft for flights. Now, that takes a couple of years to get through all of the health and safety conditions that you would expect before you can fly. So people are working really hard, I think, on this. My kind of piece about this from a big business perspective is I think there's leadership in here that's required. And so setting that vision making sure that it's bold enough so that we can address the concerns and actually move things quicker is really important. So, I mean, you alluded, David, that our challenge of 2030 for our sites is quite ambitious. It is, you know, we've got 50 sites alone in the UK, 35,000 people. Do I think that's achievable? I definitely do. I think it's a matter of having said that we want to do that, that actually we can then go and make that happen. A bit like the policy for the UK legislation, you know, as soon as we put a policy out there for our company, we can do similar things.
Really, that's really interesting. Cathy, thank you for that. That's really good to hear that. And Hayatin, on the same topic, I know that sustainability is a huge part of your five-year strategy.
Right.
Well, is that becoming, is that gaining in profile now?
I think it really is. And one thing I'd like to draw out that hasn't come through necessarily in our discussion so far is that engineers not only have a role in developing and deploying the technologies and the infrastructure that we're going to need to get to net zero, but actually they bring something very important in terms of the engineering systems approach. Because when you think about achieving net zero, it's a massive system of systems challenge. We've got to transform whole industries and whole systems and whole infrastructures from transport to housing, manufacturing, energy. It's an enormous challenge, it's a societal challenge. And unless you take a systems view, it's very hard to know where are the real points of leverage, how do you align incentives? And really importantly, how do you avoid unintended consequences? Because if you're not careful, if you don't take that systems approach, you can end up with some macabre version of whack-a-mole where your emissions pop up in another sector or in another geography. And so we've been working very hard with our friends and colleagues across the engineering community through our National Engineering Policy Centre, which brings together the more than 40 bodies that represent professional engineering in the UK, to try to take that systems approach and support policymakers in using that systems approach to inform their policy interventions around net zero. And one of the things that's quite difficult is to make it practical. You can conceptually buy into the systems approach, but you know, what does that mean in policy terms? So one of the publications that we put out this year was focused on a low regrets options framework. So helping policymakers think about action they can take now that doesn't lock you out of technological choices further down the line and is highly likely to deliver you benefits. And we also did, as another example of making this practical, a report on decarbonising construction. So the built environment accounts for a huge proportion of the UK's carbon emissions, something like 40%. And we looked at, we took a systems approach to looking at where are the opportunities to decarbonise. And you know, it really brings to life some of these other issues we're talking about, for example, around moving from the sort of linear economy model to a circular economy model, whereby we don't just think, well, this building has outlived its useful purpose for now, let's knock it down and start again. But we think about how we can reuse materials, how we can repurpose it. Look at Battersea Power Station. The iconic structure still stands, but it's being used for a very different purpose. And in the process, we've reduced the carbon footprint that's associated with that process of regeneration.
So that does require new thinking
in a fascinating way.
Thank you. Look, we could do hours on this topic. It's so interesting, but we've got to move on, I'm afraid. So look, COVID. Let's pick up the pace here. Come on, Shaun. COVID, we're not out of the woods, are we? I mean, we are still facing a problem with COVID-19, and we're going to this will run into next year. Bluntly, is enough being done? The government's strategy largely seems to be relying on vaccination. Of course, you and I, as you've alluded, we talked about ventilation and so many other measures. Is that getting the attention it now deserves, do you think?
So, I mean, Hayatin was, you know, absolutely right in terms of shouting from the rooftops about the excellent progress on vaccination that's been the engineers have played a significant role in. I think, David, what's really important is to think about all of the tools that we have available to try and tackle this pandemic. And it may well be something that we then have to live with for a very, very long time. So, for example, Omicron that's around us right now, it's going to be another variant. It won't be the last variant. This is not the last pandemic, far from it. So the vaccines are therefore an important part of our armoury, excuse the pun, but you know they are not the only aspect of it. So, for example, all of the other controls and then all of the other things that we can do to try and help reduce the likelihood of being in the presence of others. So, for example, the test and trace, and actually just voluntarily testing oneself regularly to try and make sure, as we did this evening and when we came coming in here in person, and saying, actually, I've done what I can to try and reduce the risks. And I think the government messaging on this has evolved over the last 12 months, where we've actually brought to the fore more about the ventilation, but not at the expense of diminishing actually attention to, for example, just the basic hygiene, washing your hands, wearing a face covering when it's appropriate and convenient to do so, and of course the vaccines themselves. And the vaccines will need more work going forwards as well, I'm sure, as we learn more about variants, and do those then need, you know, further modifications. So, you know, I think the government has worked very hard, and I think the really important thing is to acknowledge that this is not a UK problem. This is a global problem. Yeah. And until, and this is Jeremy Farrar, you know, until actually we've addressed vaccinations and other aspects of trying to reduce the transmission, frankly, across the globe, then we're not out of the woods, David. Yeah.
Thanks for that, Shaun. And Cathy, in what sort of ways has BAE Systems been involved in trying to tackle COVID-19?
So we've been asked several times actually to help with some of the engineering challenges, and it's quite interesting how you can apply different capabilities that we take, I suppose, as a natural capability in our business into a different industry, and it has a completely different effect. So, you know, we've taken augmented and virtual reality experts from Typhoon, for example, to do training for NHS staff on the ventilators last year. You know, and then this year, I think a key one for me is that the local NHS trust up at Morecambe Bay, they requested some help with a hood. So the kind of PPE that they have, so the personal protective equipment, is an all-encasing hood. So it goes all over your head with a big screen in the front. They had a lot of issues with it fogging up, and that, I think, really scaring some of the patients, particularly the younger ones. And the engineers, I mean, they did an absolutely amazing job really quickly of just looking at how could they improve this. They put in a continuous stream of clean filtered air, which has reduced that fogging, made, you know, facial expressions visible, lip reading possible, as well as making it more comfortable and durable. And, you know, actually those are skills that we take for granted in our industry, but have really helped a different industry move forward in what's a really difficult time.
I love those sorts of stories, Cathy. Thanks for bringing that in. Now, while all this has been going on, I mean, clearly a major concern has been about diversity and inclusion. We've touched on that in the context of vaccine equality globally. Now, George and Hyatt, you've both been on this Lewis Hamilton Commission looking at this very question, particularly in relation, I think, to motor racing, STEM generally, engineering. Yes. George, for you, what came out of that? What sort of progress did you see coming out of that process?
Sure. So there are, I think, well, first of all, I want to congratulate Lewis on such an amazing job, right? And I guess on Hyatton as well, and actually co-chairing that and ensuring that we could actually foster such a great environment for a lot of the insights to, you know, actually come to the table. So I think that's the first thing. And then the second thing that I always say, and I think it links with everything that we've said so far, and in terms of the young people's perspective, that if you're not at the table, then you're on the menu. That's kind of how I like to see it. And my brother always kind of uses that phrase, and that's why I kind of, you know, push for the local solutions and so forth. And I feel like the Hamilton Commission managed to do that. So we had the voices of young people, we had the voices of people in industry, we had academics, we had a whole host of stakeholders involved to produce, you know, a set of 10 recommendations. And these recommendations were everything from inspiration to how do we inspire more, you know, people to, you know, come into the industry, engagement, how do we actually empower these people to, you know, go forward, and then also accountability as well, and how do we measure the progress we're making, what charters can we put in place, for example. So there was a lot of different themes that we discussed, and the recommendations covered a lot of areas. In terms of progress so far, you've seen, I think, on like the inspiration and empowerment level, scholarships from institutions such as Formula One, for example, have released around 10 scholarships, which is, you know, positive. It moves in a direction, but we wanted to produce a lot more, you know, systemic change and so forth. So Mission 44, which is Lewis's foundation, was also, you know, created off the back of the Hamilton Commission as well. as kind of part of the implementation. And then there's been a lot of different bodies that have recognized that this exists and that we need to essentially find a way to reach that equity. And I feel like a lot of different people are actually actively getting involved. So we're not there just yet.
But it's encouraging
but
to
it's
hear
encouraging to see
tangible kind of steps. And Hayatin, from your perspective as a co-chair, what for you came out of it?
Yeah, I think, you know, one of the things that we really should acknowledge is it's fantastic the way that Lewis used his privilege in such a positive way for so many others, because it's relatively unusual to find someone who's got that level of influence who says, I know what problem I want to fix, but I don't know what the evidence says about the best way of doing that. So his humility in coming to us and looking at this evidence base to try to inform the work that he would then support, I think is something to be really applauded. And because of his profile, it's helped to elevate this issue across the whole of motorsport. So, you know, all of us are on our diversity and inclusion journey. I'm a great believer in having a huge amount of humility as individuals, as organisations. But there is no doubt that as a result of Lewis deciding to personally champion this, we're all going to go faster on this. And there's a huge amount that those of us outside motorsport as well can learn from the evidence base that the Commission produced. And of course, it resonates very strongly with the Academy's wider work on diversity and inclusion. We run the This Is Engineering campaign that George is one of our latest protagonists for, which is trying to attract a new and more diverse generation into engineering. Those videos have been viewed over 54 million times by a largely gender balanced audience of UK teenagers. We have This Engineering Day, which we held during COP this time. It's the first Wednesday of every November, to try to shine a light on the role that engineers play as hidden enablers of so much of our modern life that we mostly take for granted. And that's all part of trying to get to a point where these people who are shaping our world in a very profound way, developing, designing, delivering product, services, infrastructure that we all use, that literally shape our world, making sure that the people who do that are more reflective of the societies that they serve, because otherwise we risk advancing technologies in a very exciting way, but not in a way where the benefits are equitably shared.
But it's great to hear from both of you that there's obviously a huge way to go, but if you like, the right building blocks are starting to get in place. Now, a change of topic here. We can't really have a discussion at the Royal Academy of Engineering without mentioning the senior fellow, His Royal Highness Prince Philip, Duke of Edinburgh, who passed away in April, just short of his 100th birthday. Hayatin, what would you say was his legacy at the Academy and for engineering? I mean, he was known for so many things and so many causes.
Well, I mean, I don't think you can overstate the importance of Prince Philip to engineering and to the Academy. And it's maybe not so well known that he had this enormous passion for engineering and that he was actually instrumental in the creation of the Academy. So we did some research as part of a book about the origins of our organisation that really showed that without his personal intervention, he just kept on knocking heads together, not letting people off the hook, the Academy would not have come into being. And the reason that he was so committed to doing that is because he could see the importance of having a place where all these different engineering disciplines and sectors came together and provided leadership for the profession, but also to contribute to society. He's been an amazing, amazing royal patron. I don't think you could ask for more. So he was such a passionate advocate for engineering industry. He presented our McRobert Award, our highest national award for UK engineering innovation, almost continuously until very late the last few years. And I think another of his legacies will be that he's provided probably one of the most memorable quotes ever about engineering.
Are you able to share it?
Yes, I will endeavour to do it justice. Of course. Everything that wasn't invented by God is invented by an engineer. So we are working hard at the Academy to keep on honouring his vision and his legacy. We work very closely with his daughter, the Princess Royal, who's a fantastic champion for the Academy as well. She's a Royal Fellow. And we were delighted this year to award the Prince Philip Medal, the highest accolade we award to an individual, to the wonderful Gladys West, Dr. Gladys West, who, of course, did the mathematical modelling that underpinned the development of GPS rather. And we have created a Prince Philip Fund in his honour. And of course, we live when we are in a physical world at Prince Philip House. So he will continue to be very important to us.
That's so he's important in so many ways.
Absolutely.
And Shaun, I believe you met him a few times. Now, do you think he would have made a good engineer?
What a question, David. So, look, I did have the wonderful privilege of meeting Prince Philip a number of times. And the answer, David, is that he would have made an outstanding engineer. Now, the reason, and the most important reason, is that actually he was a team player. So if you think about what really makes a successful engineer, it's knowing actually what you can bring to the table and, more importantly, what you can't bring to the table, and therefore ensuring that you immerse yourself with the right team to go and actually really deliver value. But he had this uncanny knack, as I'm sure you know, we've all probably heard about. You know, you mentioned quips. Actually had very uncanny knack, or this uncanny knack of answering really awkward questions that enabled you to see things in a new light, which therefore brought out the best in your creative minds. And actually that within a team of a really high-powered functioning engineering team was incredibly valuable. So not that I met him many times, but actually it was incredible the number of times where he could just ask the most incredible questions. You might have thought it was a curveball, but it was really provoking good thinking. So I think he would have made an outstanding engineer, David.
Well, that's terrific to hear. Now look, this is the moment we flagged up earlier where we start to tackle questions from you in the audience, and thank you to all of you who've sent so many in. Let's crack straight on with them. Dr. Lucy Rogers, she asks, engineering has been lost in STEM activities. It's usually, quote, science in a lab. How can we claim the E word back? Cathy, do you want to pick up on that one first?
Gosh, that's a very interesting question, isn't it? Well, I think it hasn't been as lost as you might think, because I do think that we do quite a lot of STEM engagement in schools and things like that. And actually, you can go in and do engineering projects with them. In fact, you know, I know there are lots of people in the business that do from our perspective. So I think it's about taking the opportunities and actually doing that kind of encouragement. And I suppose, yeah, I mean, all of it's about what you put in, right? So we need to do more. And it comes back to exactly the same conversation I think George was having earlier about, you know, improving representation. All of these things, it requires effort, right? And we need to go in and talk to the communities as young as possible and encourage them, particularly in, you know, careers like ours. Yeah.
Hi, Otten, you're trying to get my attention. Does that mean you're worried that the E word has been lost and needs to be regained?
Well, I think Lucy's got a fair point, because people use the phrase STEM in a lazy way sometimes. I'm going to be a bit rude.
Actually, I used it in a lazy way. You're absolutely right.
And so, yeah. For example, they talk about, you know, we need to attract more girls into STEM. Well, actually, you have very different pictures on diversity depending on which letter in the acronym you're at. So women and girls are overrepresented, if you like, in the biosciences and subjects allied to medicine, and they're woefully underrepresented in engineering, physics, computer science. So I think it does matter. And I think it also matters that, you know, in the government sense, a lot of the time people said, when we say science, we mean all of science and technology and engineering and social sciences and humanities, and actually they don't necessarily. So I was particularly delighted to hear Sir Patrick Vallance when he did the Life Scientific talking about science and engineering. So I think it matters when you mean it. I don't think we should overemphasize disciplines for the sake of it. Collaboration is very important, multidisciplinarity is very important, but sometimes it does make a big difference. And so this is engineering, it's about reclaiming engineering.
Got it. And another question here, are we adequately preparing and equipping engineers to tackle the new and future challenges that the world faces? George, I mean, do you feel equipped for the enormous challenges that lie ahead?
So for me, I think the case is slightly different. I feel like I'm an anomaly for a lot of different reasons, which is great for me, but we're talking about other young people, right? So I think overall, not just yet. For example, I was able to study engineering at GCSE, so it wasn't just science and so forth, which was amazing. So I studied that from the age of 14. That is not common across England. So I feel like we need to be...
You were lucky in that sense.
I was lucky. That's what I mean. I'm an anomaly kind of across the board. So I think being able to actually teach subjects like that at GCSE level will essentially encourage more people and equip them with the skills of working in the workshop on, you know, the lathe or, you know, sanding. Just, you know, the kind of basic skills that you might need as an engineer to create a prototype. computer science, though, so from a technology perspective, is, you know, kind of, you know, being taught in school. So I think we just need more of that love for engineering. And that's why I became a This Is Engineering ambassador, because I'm as passionate about it as I think everyone else on the panel.
And Shaun, just picking up on that same question, I mean, do you feel that the students coming through Cambridge University, where you are equipped for the challenges that lie ahead? I mean, obviously you're going to say yes, aren't you? But I mean, there's some pretty massive challenges.
I'm going to answer it slightly differently, David. And it's not necessarily just about equipping people with the skills to be an engineer. It's about, if you need to, inspiring them to want to actually do. And this is where the difference is between climate science, which is actually studying the climate, and therefore this is the state of the nation, and doing something about it. And this is what the young people of today, I know I'm bringing us back to that earlier thing about COP26, and actually what the people want to go and make a difference. They want to go and sort this mess out, okay? And that is not about science. The science just tells us what's going on. Actually, what we're going to do, in large part, are engineering solutions, engineering approaches to go and actually supporting nature, amplifying those. So engineering is something that is now, I think, very much more in the hearts and minds of young people. But back to the question, I'm now answering it correctly, we do need to make sure that we're providing them with the educational tools. But you know, the inspiration aspect, I'm afraid, this is where climate change, unfortunately, you know, I wish it wasn't climate change, but climate change is providing a very big lever here of getting people interested in what can we do to actually sort this out.
Because there are opportunities to tackle the threat. So that leads me to another one. So a question here, the ExoMars mission will go to Mars next year. Does space exploration inspire people about engineering, or should we concentrate on solving problems on Earth? Who would I want to pick up? Cathy, I mean, focus on Earth or look to the heavens?
Oh, come on, he's not inspired by space, right? We all want to do that. So yeah, I mean, you know, space is a really exciting area at the moment. So in particularly the low Earth orbit is an area that's growing in terms of capability. And, you know, I mean, there are simple things that are becoming so much more accessible in terms of that particular part of space, where you can put up applications that can look at anything now, really, can't they, across the world? I mean, you know, it's incredible in terms of the change, I suppose, in the size, weight and power aspects of things that can go into LEO now that would have gone, you know, probably into a geo orbit before and would have been absolutely enormous. Yeah, I mean, it's opened doors everywhere. It's brilliant. Yeah.
I mean, interestingly, just to sort of, if you like, pick up on the opposite of that, Hayatin, there was a bit of pushback, certainly on social media, when some of the billionaires were lofting themselves into well, let's call it generously, the edges of space. I mean, how do you think space plays as an inspiration for engineers?
Well, so I think part of the problem is the people we want to inspire into engineering are not a homogenous group. People are inspired by different things. Mm-hmm. So it's clear that space has real resonance for some young people, but not for others. I'm delighted if people who are cross about these billionaires going into space end up doing engineering because they're so motivated by solving our problems here on Earth. That's fine by me. I'm agnostic. And I also think that, you know, we need to harness opportunities for radical innovation. So the pandemic showed us what radical innovation can do. And that radical innovation can provide us with all sorts of tools that if we're smart and, you know, really motivated to tackle the key societal problems, we can do useful things with. And, you know, similarly, some people are excited by the opportunity for AI to be changing our lives. I mean, I think one of the most exciting developments from the last year has been AlphaFold. It's not that widely talked about, but this is using AI to solve a huge grand challenge in biology. It's not going to excite everybody, but it's going to change our lives, because understanding how the sequence of a protein relates to 3D structure is something people have been struggling with for decades. And that will enable us to have a whole new platform of technologies, tools and insights that will go on to improve our lives. So it's not always possible to point at what's good innovation and bad innovation. It's what we do with those insights and those advances that matters.
You don't mind where the inspiration comes from. What about you, George? Do you find it's exciting, Elon Musk and his plans to go to Mars and all the rest of it? Or do you think, actually, there are some back to Peckham High Street.
Yeah.
All right? Yeah. There are some serious challenges now that need sorting.
As you can probably tell, I'm more of a local
lad. You're more of a Peckham High Street.
I'm more of a local lad. Yes. Peckham High Street is probably where my heart resides. So I'm more of a 80-20. So I think in terms of space, and kind of that side of things, probably 20%, because I think it does inspire people and a lot of people. But a lot of people where I'm around, they've got problems here and today that I don't think their head can even be in space and thinking about what can we do there. But at times it does help some of them dream. So I think there's a balance that we have to get, but I think 80% of me would really want to just solve the issues that we have here and now, because the inequalities are rife.
And I suppose another angle on this is that, you know, and Cathy, you've touched on this about low Earth orbit, the satellites and so forth. We've got a better view, haven't we, Shaun, of the Earth and its problems because of its capability. I mean, one could turn it that way around.
And indeed, and I think there are clearly lessons for engineering. So if somebody does go and do developments of work in space, very often, as a result of those technology developments, there are things that then can be applied elsewhere, as we've actually, that's a story throughout space. But I do remember, David, when I was chief executive of Breathing Buildings, and we were trying to recruit somebody, an engineer, and actually this guy was going to be great, and we made him a job offer, and then he turned us down. He turned us down and said, I've got a job offer from somebody else to go and design the next Mars rover, right? Now, there were various colleagues on my team who said, well, Shaun, you know, exciting though Breathing Buildings is, you know, we've got to go and, you know, hand it to the person that, you know, that's more really exciting. For me, back to high art, and actually I'm agnostic. I care about the planet. I actually think what Breathing Buildings were trying to do was even more important and more exciting, but therefore we're a broad church. And therefore, I'm going to just echo High Ayrton's voice, really saying, look, different things will excite different people. And the important thing is to bring people into the fold to make the world a better place, which is fundamentally what engineering is about.
OK, so this next question bumps us into the awkward world of politics. Dr. Juan Carlos Tejeda Gonzalez says, most issues have a strong economic and political background. How does engineering deal with political interests behind climate change and so many other issues? I mean, we saw that loom pretty large in the final hours of COP26, for example, countries with the big coal producers making sure that the language on coal was watered down. Shaun, you look like you're poised with an answer there.
So, I am. And yes, one can immediately conclude that there's a lot of politics involved. But actually, I'm going to go one level below that, which is then what drives the politics, and it's people. And actually, therefore, that's actually very common to engineering. Of course, we were talking earlier, engineering, we are a people-centric sector. Now, fundamentally, I think one of the big issues regarding lack of progress in tackling climate change is down to money and economics. And therefore, for example, the $100 billion a year that have been promised, and that they're not being actually forthcoming, and therefore the erosion of trust between certain aspects of society on a global basis. And therefore, it is a political thing. But those politicians are going to be wanting to get voted in the next 5 years. And it comes down to, therefore, what they think their voters will actually therefore want. And in large part, it's very easy to point the fingers at politicians, point the fingers at other people. And I'm all for one to say, well, actually I want to point the finger at myself, because as the developed world, maybe it's ourselves in terms of how willing are we to, for example, to have increased taxes. And therefore it becomes a societal issue, David, very quickly, not just by looking at political.
And presumably to link that with a point, Cathy, you made earlier about the business case for renewable energy, presumably the politics can shift if the economic reality changes, for example, of renewable energy.
Yeah, I think so. I think you're quite right. And there's obviously that three life argument as well in terms of how we make it work properly. But you know, ultimately, I mean, the people piece is super important in here, because actually we've got to help people understand how they can operate in a new world. You know, and just coming right back to the start, we said that, you know, actually, even if we do as much as we can at the moment, the world is changing. Climate change isn't going to go away. So actually what we do now has to operate in a completely different environment tomorrow. And engineers are fundamental to actually helping people through that transition, and not just providing kit that they can use, but actually understanding that kind of change curve that people have to go through. And that's hugely political, actually, really, when you think about it.
And Hyatin, do you sometimes sense that there are what to engineers seem completely logical solutions? Well, obviously the world should do this or that, bump into the reality of politics.
So I spent some time working in Parliament, and I feel very strongly that experts, including engineers, need to feel it's their responsibility to participate in the democratic process and to support policymakers in understanding both what their policy options are and how, in practical terms, to deliver policy objectives. So at the end of the day, we have a shared interest in delivering this massive societal change that we all need to happen. Engineers have to be part of that, but so do politicians. And so I think that, you know, one can sit there and sort of lob rocks at each other or just critique. That's not helping anybody. So personally, I'm a big fan of just finding ways to create a constructive dialogue where the expertise and the capability of the engineering profession is made more closely available to policymakers and to empathise more with the fact that they are driven by factors that are not the same factors driving an individual engineer. And finally, just to say that I also think, I talked about systems approach before. Engineers all need to be considering what they do as part of a socio-technical system. Every engineer
system. So no ivory tower.
It involves people. Yeah. It's not a systems approach if you don't think about the people interacting with the technology and the engineering.
That's so interesting. And a lot of questions here about young people, inspiring young people. What can we do to get more young people into engineering? I know we've touched on this already. But George, is there like one thing that you think could make a real difference? I know you've worked on this and you've...
Yeah, I guess at Motives, a lot of the work that we do is predominantly around getting young people into science, technology, engineering, maths, with a bias for engineering and technology, because that's where most of our experience is as a team. And I think the climate at the moment is the biggest motivator, as you mentioned, unfortunately. But for us, it's like that is a big interest. So we're very much using that and designing grassroots programs to support them and create green leaders who essentially become advocates and advise different companies on how should they shape their, you know, sustainability policies, how should they shape their internships. So actually giving them a voice. So I find that creating these grassroots programs and hopefully getting them sponsored by different partners and so forth is a good way to go. And a lot of corporates, for example, can be involved in that, as opposed to putting all the onus on the young people to do the work, because that's probably not right. So we think if more people collaborate in order to make the change, I think we can definitely inspire a lot more young people. And that's what we try to do through the This Is Engineering campaign. So more campaigns like that and more programs to actually support these young people to develop that, you know, practical nature and solve the solutions, create the prototypes and say, maybe we can make a difference.
Now we're getting into the final real minute or so. So this is like almost a one word answer, okay? A question that's coming. What kind of engineering project would you like to see in a TV program made about next year? Let's broaden it from TV program to YouTube video. I don't know how many of George's generation watch TV anymore. My kids don't watch TV. Cathy, what, just in a word or two, what would you most like to see of engineering given high profile to a mass audience?
Gosh, that's so hard. that's so hard. So my particular thing is obviously synthetic fuels, and I'm just thinking, how would you make that interesting?
Well, I'm sure there's a way of doing
there's
that.
There's a challenge.
Shaun, a breathing building, a healthy building.
No, mine would be, what engineering approaches could we develop that we don't have right now that will get us to 1.5 degrees C?
Okay, that's a good one. All right, George?
I'll stick to what I know around electric vehicles and really making that as exciting as possible. And that's the work that we're doing with Extreme E. So I'd like to see that get a bigger profile.
Okay, Hyatin.
Back to what I said earlier, you need to show the diversity of impacts that engineers can have. And so anything that shows that engineering is a high social impact, human-centric profession that enables you to be part of shaping the future.
With the emphasis on the human.
Human. It's all about people.
You've all said that, and that's so interesting. That's a great note to end on. Thank you all very, very much indeed. I mean, that's all we've got time for. There are more questions, Time has suddenly flown by in, I think, I hope, a really productive and certainly for me a fascinating way. And I think we've covered a really great lot of ground there. So a big thank you to Cathy in Bristol, Shaun, George, Hayatin. It's been tremendous to have this little session together, and I hope more in future. Clearly, there's an awful lot in store for us next year, things we know about, major meetings on climate, the pandemic rolling on, and let's hope that we get on top of that around the world, not just in the UK. And let's hope engineers yet again come to the rescue. But thank you very, very much for watching. It's been a great pleasure for me, and good luck and enjoy the rest of your evening. Thank you.